Prime Minister, President Niinistö and Prime Minister Sipilä and High Representative Vice President Mogherini. It's great to be here together with all of you today and to take part in this inauguration of this center to counter hybrid threats. It is especially good to be here together with you because this shows how we are moving forward on the NATO-EU cooperation, and Federica just described that. But let me add, it also describes and is yet another example of how we are moving together, not only to strengthen NATO-EU cooperation, but also how NATO is strengthening the cooperation with partner countries as Finland. And Sauli, you remember that last November you visited me at the NATO headquarters, and that was actually I was not aware of that before you told me, but that was the first time a Finnish president had visited the NATO headquarters. So it's yet another example of how we step by step are strengthening NATO-EU cooperation, but also NATO cooperation with EU members and partner countries like Finland. And this center illustrates how we are also delivering concrete results as part of this cooperation. Then I would also like to underline that for NATO it is important to have partners like Finland because you are a very highly valued and important partner for the whole of NATO. You contribute to NATO missions and operations. You have done that for many, many years in the Balkans, in Kosovo, in Afghanistan. I recently visited Afghanistan. I met Finnish soldiers and personnel there. And you're also participating in NATO exercises, in NATO Response Force. You are helping, working together with NATO in many different ways. It's good for NATO, and I hope it's also good for Finland. Then you have a special skill, or Finland has a special role to play when it comes to developing NATO's relationship with Russia. Because you have the long border with Russia, you have the long relationship with Russia. This year you celebrated 100 years of independence, and you know better than I that those 100 years is very much about Finland's relationship to the neighbor in the east, to Russia, in good times and in bad times. And the Finnish border with Russia is longer than the combined border of all NATO allies with Russia. So therefore, I would also like to thank you, Finland, for what you do when it comes to sharing knowledge, experience, analysis on the relationship with Russia, which is also important for NATO. Add to that that we have now one concrete example where we are working together and where NATO is playing a key role, and that is when it comes to, we call it air safety or safety in the Baltic region. Air safety, the issues we have seen with some incidents, some accidents, some dangerous situations. NATO discussed it, we discussed it in the NATO-Russia Council, I discussed it with the President, and now there's a very constructive process going on within the ICAO framework to address how can we agree on guidelines, on arrangements to increase air safety also for when it comes to military planes, state-owned aircrafts in the Baltic Sea region. We still have some work to do, but Finland is the key country in leading and hosting that process, which brings together NATO allies, Russia, Baltic states, and then working on how can we actually make some real progress in addressing something which has been of great concern for all of us. So my first message is to thank you. Thank Finland for the partnership with NATO and for being an important platform also for developing the political dialogue with Russia. Let me also add that when you mentioned the example with the bicycles, you know that up in the north we have a border with Russia. And suddenly thousands of people showed up there, and it was called Pestamo, but now it's called Pechenga, and they started to cross the borders. And the odd thing is that anyone wants to cross the border into Norway in the middle of winter. Not normal. But the second thing was that instead of skis, they brought bicycles. And that's because it's forbidden by law to cross the Norwegian-Russian border on foot. It's not a Norwegian law, it's a Russian law. So then the easiest way to get a vehicle was to buy a bicycle. So they actually brought thousands of bicycles into Norway. They didn't smuggle bicycles, but they actually were fleeing war and the refugees coming to Norway. This was back in 2015, but it illustrated it was actually bicycles that was a big issue in much of the coverage of all those people crossing that border. Then I agree with what the president and the high representative have said about the importance of this center. Let me just add some reflections and some points. And the first thing is that hybrid threats are many different threats. And we use the phrase hybrid to cover actually many different things. Normally a kind of mixture of military and non-military means of aggression, a combination of covert and overt operations and measures, everything from propaganda, from disinformation, to actually the use of regular forces, from tweets to tanks, sometimes soldiers in uniform, sometimes soldiers without uniform, and sometimes something that happens in the cyberspace, and sometimes things that happens at our borders. And it is this combination of so many different things at the same time, with the aim to disguise and to hide the real intention that has got the name hybrid threats. And it's a kind of buzzword which I hear every place or everywhere I go now. Therefore, I think it is important to remind us all of the fact that covert operations, disinformation, the efforts to try to disguise your intentions, that's not something new. It is at least as old as the Trojan horse. So it has happened before. If there is something new, then it is the scale and the scope and the speed. So it's used more now. And the speed has increased because you can, for instance, use cyber, the internet, to conduct a lot of your hybrid measures. And therefore, NATO has responded. We have responded in close cooperation with the European Union. We have responded in close cooperation with partner countries like Finland. Just to briefly mention what we have done, I'll mention at least three areas where we have reacted and adapted. The first thing we have done is to improve our situational awareness, meaning to improve the way of understanding what is going on. Because one of the main challenges with hybrid threats is that you don't understand that you are attacked before it's too late. So everything that can improve our intelligence, our surveillance, and our reconnaissance is also a way to prepare and to react and to defend against hybrid threats. Therefore, we have established a new division only working with intelligence in NATO. We are improving the ways we are sharing and analyzing and understanding intelligence, which is extremely important for also addressing hybrid threats. We are developing our reconnaissance and surveillance capabilities. We will soon deploy or have some new NATO drones, which will be key in a hybrid situation to improve situational awareness. And we are also working, of course, with the European Union, also when it comes to sharing information, improving the way to analyze and to understand the hybrid threats. So that's the first area of response from NATO. Improved situational awareness to be able to foresee and understand what is going on. The second thing we have done is to significantly increase the readiness of our forces. And we have done that in different ways. we have tripled the size of what we call the NATO response force to 30,000 troops. We have, as part of that, established a new joint high readiness brigade, or a VJTF, a very high readiness joint task force, which is a brigade that can react within a few days. And perhaps for at least many countries, perhaps the most important element is that we have actually increased our military presence in some of those countries which are most exposed. We have deployed four battle groups to the three Baltic countries and Poland, and also increased our presence in the southeast of the alliance. So just the fact that we now have troops, and not all, multinational troops in the three Baltic countries and Poland, of course, increases significantly our ability to react fast if something happens. So the deployment of the battle groups, the new high readiness joint task force, and the tripling of the size of the NATO response force, all of that altogether and other measures have increased the readiness, meaning our ability to react quickly if needed, and if we see small green men showing up somewhere where they should not show up. Then NATO will be there. And the third thing we have done to respond to a more challenging security environment with a more more hybrid threats is to improve our resilience. And we have done that in many different ways, and again, in cooperation with the European Union and partners as Finland. Perhaps the most important area where we have improved our resilience is when it comes to infrastructure. We work with also in the EU when it comes to, for instance, infrastructure, energy security, but in particular cyber. And that's part about being able to defend our own networks. There is no military operation, there is no military activity, there is no military conflict without a big cyber dimension. So we have to be able to support and defend our own networks. But of course, it's also about working with the European Union. We have an arrangement with the European Union. We have experts exchanging information, sharing experiences on how to help member states, NATO members, EU members, to strengthen their resilience and their ability to defend their own cyber networks. And that's extremely important, because we have seen that many of the hybrid threats, they actually take the form as different kinds of hybrid attacks, undermining our democratic processes, reducing our ability to have free and open discussions without fake news and disinformation. That's also an area where we have learned a lot from Finland, because you have really focused in so many years on resilience, on how to be able to protect your own societies and your own infrastructure and networks. And that's yet another example of how we believe or really see that the cooperation with Finland is of mutual benefit both for Finland and for NATO. And then we have this center, which is a new building block in how we are responding to hybrid threats. And I strongly believe that to have a center like this as a hub for sharing information, for sharing experiences, for learning from each other, from organizing training, and for also doing some practical work and looking into how we can address specific hybrid threats, it will be of great advantage both for EU, for NATO, and of course for all our member states, including Finland. So it is an important thing that we have been able to develop this center. It has been supported by the EU, by NATO, but I would like to especially commend Finland for your strong support and for funding and for hosting this center, which will be of high value for all of us. Let me also add that this center is important also because it will link and work together with other centers of excellence. There is a center of excellence in Estonia, a NATO center of excellence in Estonia on cyber threats, on cyber defense. We have a center of excellence in Latvia on strategic communications, and we have a center of excellence in Lithuania on energy security. And energy security and strategic communications and cyber are all elements in addressing hybrid threats. And I know that the directors of the four centers, this center and the three centers in the Baltic countries, they will meet tomorrow and make sure that they are linking together. And then we become even stronger by making sure that the different center of excellence addressing cyber threats in different ways are working closely together. And once again, it underlines the NATO-EU dimension. Last July, we signed a declaration, President Juncker, President Tusk and I, on NATO-EU cooperation. Then Federica and I, we developed 42 measures, many of them highly relevant for hybrid attacks. And now we are implementing the 42 measures on cyber, on exercises, and many other areas. And then we will also start to work on how can we add to those measures to make sure that we not only implement what we agreed, but also develop new areas where we can further strengthen the NATO-EU cooperation. So I am inspired by the fact that we have been able to reach so far in such a short time. And I remember also very well the first time Federica and I met, because that also, not the first time we met, because that's many years ago, but the first time we met as a high representative vice president and secretary general. And since then, we have met very regularly and worked very hard on how we can strengthen the NATO-EU cooperation. And it's good to see that we are making progress. So many thanks to the European Union and many thanks to Finland for making this day possible and for making this center something which is now going to be opened. Thank you.